In today's class, we'll be studying about the fungal pathogens known as downy mildews. These are fungi belonging to the lower group called as class oomycetes. Now, as they belong to the lower group of fungi, they show cenocytic mycelium. Cenocytic means aseptate, that is, there are hypha which do not have septa in them, or in other words, it is called as cenocytic. These organisms are obligate parasites, which means they cannot grow without a living cell. That means they cannot be isolated or grown on a non-living media. These organisms, being obligate parasites, are characterized by knob-like haustoria. Now, haustoria are the intracellular structures that are produced by these pathogens to absorb the nutrients from the host. So, the host here is the plant, and the organism is producing haustoria to absorb the nutrition. It is also characterized by club-shaped sporangiophores. These sporangiophores are asexual reproductive hypha. At the tip of the sporangiophore, there will be a club-shaped or a spherical vesicle called, or a sac-like structure called as the sporangium. Inside the sporangium are the asexual spores called as the sporangiospores. These organisms are known to produce sexual spores called as oospores, and asexual spores which are zoospores. These asexual spores, which are also called as zoospores, are nothing but the sporangiospores. They are called as zoospores because they are motile or they have a flagella. So the primary spread of the inoculum is with the help of oospores, whereas the secondary spread is with the help of zoospores. Now, when I say primary spread, it means the organism has to survive the unfavorable conditions for it to establish an infection in a new season. That surviving of the organism in the unfavorable conditions is called as overwintering. So the inoculum has to get over or tide over the unfavorable conditions, or it has to overwinter, and the overwintering is brought about by the oospores or the sexual spores. The zoospores are those which help in spread of the organism from one plant to another plant, or from one plant to its neighboring plant. That is brought about by zoospores, which are the asexual spores. So the overwintering of the inoculum in this case is with the help of oospores. That is the primary spread, whereas the secondary spread, once the infection has established in one or two plants, from one plant to the next plant, it is spread with the help of zoospores. That is called as the secondary spread. So there are different species that are important. For example, in grapes, it is Plasmopara viticola. In sunflower, it is Plasmopara halsteadi. Both of these are Plasmopara species, though all of them belong to the order Peronosporales under the class Oomycetes. There are different genera. So the genus Plasmopara viticola is causing in grapes, whereas Plasmopara halsteadi is causing in sunflower. Peronospora pisci is known to be the pathogen that causes downy mildew of peas, whereas Peronospora parasitica causes in crucifers. And Pseudoperonospora cubensis is known to cause downy mildews in cucurbits. So these are some of the important species of downy mildew. This is just to show you the different examples. So this is Peronospora, this is Plasmopara, and this is Pseudoperonospora. Now, coming to the first one, so we'll be doing two type studies under this. That is, downy mildew of grapes is the first one. Downy mildew of grapes is caused by the organism Plasmopara viticola. Like I have already told you, it shows aseptate or cenocytic mycelium and a globose haustoria. So the haustoria is spherical or globular in shape, and it shows aseptate mycelium. The sexual reproduction occurs by the fusion of antheridium, which is the male gametangium or the male sex organ, and oogonium, which is the female sex organ. When antheridium and oogonium fuse with each other within the host tissue, when they fuse with each other, there is a formation of a zygote, and then the zygote divides to form a spore, which is called as the oospore. So oospore is, like I have already told you, the sexual spore. This is the spore which helps in survival and resting stage of the pathogen, or this is the one which helps the pathogen to overwinter during unfavorable conditions. Now, the oospores will produce sporangia. These sporangia will produce the zoospores. So, oospores are the primary inoculum. They overwinter, and once they begin to germinate, after germination from the grapes or from any part of the grape plant,
These oospores spores will form when they, during the germination, they will form a single germ tube. This germ tube will end in a big sporangium, and inside the sporangium, zoospores are being produced. These sporangia, which are now produced at the tip of the oospore, will help in secondary spread of the pathogen. So the sporangiophores, which bear these sporangia, emerge through the stomata of the leaf. So till now, everything was happening inside the tissue of the leaf. Now these sporangiophores will be protruding outside the leaf, and these sporangiophores have sporangia at their tips. We will see this in the diagram soon. Within the sporangia, or within every sporangium, there are zoospores which are then released. Zoospores, being motile, will swim freely in the water, which can be present on the grape vine, it can be present on the grape buds, on the grape fruits, on the bark of the tree, anywhere where there is water, these zoospores will swim freely, and they will then germinate. Once they germinate, they will now penetrate through the stoma of a new leaf or of a new plant with the help of a germ tube. These penetrate the plant through the stomata, so they will enter only through a green or a living host tissue. Like I have already told you, they are obligate parasites. So they will enter through a functioning stomata and cause a new infection. Now, these sporangia and zoospores are easily desiccated. They can survive only up to 2 to 3 hours. It is the oospores which survive over unfavorable conditions. Let us see whatever I have told you in the form of a diagram. Please concentrate on the red dot that is there, that is going to move. So we start with an encysted zoospore. Now the zoospore has fallen on a new leaf or on a new plant. This zoospore can cause either a leaf infection, it can infect the berry, that is a grapefruit, or it can infect the twig. Once it goes inside, so it will penetrate that particular part of the plant through a germ tube. This germ tube will go inside, it will multiply, and asexually it will form more of its own type. So the zoospore is going to multiply asexually to form intercellular mycelia with haustoria. So now I have inside the entire tissue, I'm having several mycelial strands with haustoria that are being produced. Haustoria are present inside the plant cell, which are helping the organism to absorb the nutrition. Now, once the haustoria have been produced, they keep multiplying. This leads to spread of the infection within the same plant. This leads to either an infected leaf or an infected grape cluster or an infected twig. Now, once the multiplication or the reproduction continues, sporangiophores, which bear a sporangium at the tip, are now seen protruding outside the cell. So you can see over here, sporangiophores are now protruding outside the tissue. So they start protruding outside either the bark tissue or the leaf tissue or the fruit tissue. Once these sporangiophores are projecting outside, now let us see what they are exactly comprising of. So these sporangia now contain several spores inside. So inside the sporangium, we have the sporangium undergoing meiosis to form several spores, and these spores are now going to be called as the zoospores. This zoospore is traveling along with the water, or it can be even carried by the wind. It moves on to a new plant where it again establishes an infection, and the entire cycle of asexual reproduction is being repeated. So I'll quickly repeat once again. Once the zoospore has fallen, the encysted zoospore has fallen on a particular part of the plant, it enters the plant, it multiplies inside. Once it multiplies inside, the sporangiophores, which bear globose sporangia or which bear round sporangia at the tip, are now projecting outside. Every sporangium will be having several zoospores inside it. So the sporangium will germinate and it will have several zoospores inside. You can see the zoospores that are inside. Once the sporangium wall breaks, the zoospores are released, and this continues the infection in a different plant. This is just the asexual part of the life cycle. Now the zoospore can also enter into sexual life cycle. So, or the organism can also enter into the sexual life cycle. In that case, the antheridium and the oogonium will now come together. Antheridium is the male organ, male sex organ, and oogonium is the female sex organ. The antheridium and the oogonium come and contact with each other. They undergo gametangial contact. There is plasmogamy, there is karyogamy, or both the nuclei fuse. After both the nuclei fuse, you can see over here, after the fusion of the two nuclei, we have formation of an oospore. So both antheridium and oogonium, that is the male and female sex organs, have come near each other. They have fused with each other, and now there is formation of an oospore. The oospore is released, or oospore which is present inside the infected part of the plant. Now it falls onto the ground, either when the leaf is shed or if the leaves are cut. In one way or the other, it reaches the ground. Once it reaches the ground, there it will survive till the unfavorable conditions tide over, or till the unfavorable conditions are gone. The organism will survive in the soil in the form of an oospore. This oospore will then, when it comes in contact with the suitable substratum, it will germinate. You can see over here, it will germinate. At when it germinates, at the tip of the oospore germ tube, a sporangium is being formed. And from the sporangium, inside the sporangium, again this entire cycle will repeat. So inside the sporangium, we have zoospores. The zoospore will be released and it will get encysted. So the same cycle is being now repeated. What I had shown you first was the asexual life cycle. This is the sexual part, wherein a male and female spore, or male and female antheridium and oogonium, come with each other and form an oospore. Oospore are the sexual spores. Zoospore are the asexual spores. Once the zoospores are formed, they'll again cause infection on a massive scale. That is why it leads to secondary spread of the pathogen. So this is just a diagram that I have shown you, in broken into two pieces. It is just being shown as a whole. If you want, you can draw this diagram in your exam, or even a simpler diagram like this can be used. It shows the same thing. They have shown differently about oospore. This is the part where oospores are being shown, and this is the part where zoospores are being shown. But ultimately, what you need to remember here is that oospore is a sexual spore. Oospore is helping the organism to tide over the unfavorable conditions. Oospore will form a germ tube. At the tip of the germ tube, there will be a sporangium. Inside the sporangium, there will be several zoospores. Zoospores are motile. That is why they are called as zoospores. They have flagella. So the zoospores will be released. Once they are released, they will enter a tissue. It can be any part of the grape plant, where it will multiply and it will form sporangia and sporangiophores. These sporangiophores with the sporangia will now protrude outside the tissue, or they will be seen outside the tissue. Inside every sporangia, there are several zoospores which are released, and again the cycle repeats. Coming to the symptoms of the disease. So symptoms can be seen on the leaves 5 to 7 days after infection. On the leaf, there will be initially circular spots, yellow circular spots, which have an oily appearance. These will be surrounded by a small, or by a faded brownish yellow halo. The halo will fade, or it will go off as the oil spot increases in size or it matures. Below the leaves, on the underside of the leaves, there is white downy fungal growth. That is why the name is called as downy mildew. This fungal growth is nothing but the sporangia and sporangiophores, which are now protruding outside the tissue. So there will be white undergrowth on the underside of the leaf, white downy growth. Not only the leaf, on every infected plant part, it will be seen. So you can see over here, these are the pale yellow spots that are seen on the upper surface of the leaf, the oily spots, and this is the white downy growth. It's just another example to show you. These are the yellow spots, what you can see here, and this is the downy growth. These are basically the sporangiophores of the fungus coming outside. This is to show you attack of the grape berry. So even when grape berries are infected, you can see the downy growth outside. Coming to the disease control. So if the organism has to survive, like I told you, zoospores need water to swim onto or to move onto another part of the plant or another plant. So moisture will favor the development of the downy mildew. Hence, grapevines should be established in well-drained sites or well-drained areas where there is good air movement. Leaf litter and pruning should be reduced, because this will reduce the amount of overwintering inoculum. So if the leaf litter contains inoculum that is overwintering or contains oospores, it will affect the next crop that is being planted over there, or the next season's crops. Instead, if the leaf litter is removed or the leaf litter is reduced, the overwintering inoculum will not be present. There are many disease resistant varieties which I have been developed. So these disease resistant varieties can be used. Example, there is a variety that is Sultana, which is very susceptible to the disease, whereas Chardonnay or Sauvignon is a variety that is less susceptible, or that is resistant. So choosing a particular resistant variety is also an option that is there for all the pathogens that we'll be studying from now onwards. Use of fungicides. Now, there are several fungicides, but especially those which include copper or copper-based fungicides like Bodo mixture, Maneb, Zineb, Mancozeb. These are common fungicides that are known to be effective to control downy mildew. So, we have done the life cycle, the how pathogens, mode of transmission, how it is going to get transmitted, what is the source of primary spread, what is the source of secondary spread. We have done the basic structure of the pathogen. I have told you that it contains aseptate mycelia and it shows haustoria, it shows porangiophores. There are oospores, which are the sexual spores, zoospores, which are the asexual spores. After that, we did the symptoms and the disease control. All this we have done for Plasmopara viticola, which causes downy mildew of grapes. Now, I will do one more downy mildew example, that is downy mildew of peas. Like I told you, symptoms are similar. You just need to change the causal organism. So here the causal organism is Peronospora pisci. It belongs to the same order as Plasmopara viticola. Hence, it shows a cenocytic mycelium. Now, cenocytic is aseptate mycelium, which is profusely branched. And it shows intercellular mycelium. That means mycelium that is present in between the cells of the plant tissue. Here again, the asexual spores are sporangiospores, which are produced within a sporangium. And these sporangia are held on reproductive hypha called as the sporangiophores. These sporangiophores along with the sporangia will protrude outside the stomata or protrude through the stomata. The oospores are the sexual spores which help in overwintering or helping the inoculum to tide over the unfavorable conditions. The disease cycle is also similar. The moist, cool weather is what is conducive to the development of disease, and it is a soil-borne disease, that is the oospores which are present in the soil will be the source of primary spread. They enter inside a peas plant and they multiply rapidly over there. When they multiply, a germ tube is formed. At the end of the germ tube, there is a sporangium. Inside the sporangium, there are zoospores. This sporangium is what is going to help in secondary spread. So the sporangium is released. It falls on a suitable substratum. It releases the zoospores. The zoospores will now help in secondary spread of the infection. So this life cycle that you are going to write about is similar to that as what you have studied under grapes plant. Coming to the symptoms, downy growth can be seen on the underside of the leaves here as well. You can see that there is downy growth here. It shows grayish violet downy or growth, mycelial growth. The pea pods will also have pale green patches on the side. So there will be pale green elliptical patches or blotches on the side, which then become darker or become brown in color as they mature. These are the symptoms that are found in downy mildew of peas. And the disease control is also similar. It includes application of copper-based fungicides like Bodo mixture, cultural practices, that means crop rotation, not growing the plant every year or alternating the plant with a non-host plant, and by destruction of the infected debris.